Hi, my name is Russ Beach, and I'm going to be helping you groom your dogs. This is our Grooming from Nose to Tail seminar. This is going to be my assistant, Mo Foley. The first thing we're starting with is line brushing your dog. The first thing you want to do is completely mist your dog to get it just slightly damp. You don't want it soaking wet. The reason for this is damp hair will stretch and not break. So you always want to brush the coat damp. And you want to start at the base of the ear, working forward in very short lines. As you'll see, she'll miss the dog. She's keeping a fairly straight line. Doesn't have to be perfect. And then brushing in the opposite direction of the coat. This separates the coat all the way down to the skin. It'll give it a lot more body. We're going to let her groom for few more minutes, and we'll talk about some other things, but you'll see the effect of this on this dog's body with just plain water and a pin brush. I will show you some of the basic things you will be needing for grooming. If you don't have them, you can probably buy them at almost any dog show. You can find them in many catalogs, New England Serum, things like that. The main thing you need for a Belgian is a good pin brush. I highly recommend the Chris Christensen brushes for two reasons. They really have a nice length of pin for a Belgian coat, and the tips are all polished. If you try one of these brushes of a different brand on your skin, you'll see what it does. When you use Chris Christensen, because they're polished tips, it's easier on the skin. I don't get anything from this. I'm just saying I've worked with every kind of brush there is. I highly recommend these brushes. They're more expensive than the other ones. They're easier on your dog. That's why I like them. They've also improved them quite a bit. The glue is much better now, so the pins stay in there quite a bit better.
What number is that?
27. I prefer this. There's the oval and the oblong. This is a Mason Pearson brush. Most of you won't need to go out and get this. This is like an $80 brush. It's made for people, but I like it for finishing. After I've done a line brushing, before I go in the ring, I use a finishing brush to tidy him up a little bit without having to get all the way down the coat. This won't get down into the coat to the skin. But it does a nice job on the outer coat, as you can see it. Leaves a nice finished look. Something else you'll need is a slicker brush. I don't care what brand. I do have the Chris Christensen that somebody bought me as a gift. But any kind of slicker brush with a softer bristle is best to use on the short coat of the legs. We can get one that's real harsh with too long of a pin. They will scratch the skin. You don't want to dig this down into the skin too deep. They do scratch. Dogs scratch just like anything else. A very valuable tool is an undercoat rake. Now this one has two different kinds of pins in it of two different lengths. It really works good for getting all the way down into the skin. You can see how far down that goes into the coat. When the dogs are blowing coat, that's invaluable. That'll save you a lot of time. And if you start line brushing your dog, you won't need to use this very often. But it's nice when you're first starting with the dog to use a rake to get out all the dead undercoat and then follow up with a pin brush. A good Greyhound comb. I have no preference for a brand, just cheap comb. I usually lose more of them than I ever get to use. A lot of people borrow them, you know, things like that happen. On the tails, I use what I call a horse and mane comb first, which is a wider tooth. As you can see, that works real good at getting down into the tails and the manes, and then follow up something a little closer, and then working down to the small. be perfectly groomed if you do that. The tails are really sensitive areas for your dogs. I know most of you that have tried it, your dogs hate to have their tails and feet done. Other things you need is a good pair of clippers, nice and sharp. If they start leaving splintering when you're doing the dog's nails, throw them away, go get another pair. They're not that expensive, it's worth it. I prefer grinders just because I think that they're a little bit safer. I've never drawn blood with grinders. I know people have, but that's because they use them incorrectly. But yeah, you really have to watch these around the coat. They will rip the coat right out of your dog from the roots. Something else that you might need is some good scissors. Now, these are my thinning shears. I've had these for probably 15 years. I use them a lot. I show every single weekend. I groom a lot of people's dogs. They've been sharpened once. Okay, this is Economy brand 4420. That's the number of teeth it has per inch. I like this best depending on where you're using on the dog's body. It doesn't leave lines like other thinning shears do. Like I said, I probably paid 80 bucks for them 15 years ago. They'll last and last and last and last and last. So get your. Sometimes you have to pay a little bit more for quality. Okay. Now, as you can see, I wanted to follow up with Mo. She's still following that line all the way back through the dog's body. And if you, this dog is very good for this. This is why we're using him. Now, she'll do this all the way back to the base of the tail, turn him over, do the other side, do the top, and the underside.
Everything
goes forward. In the opposite direction, it grows. Okay, some other things that I'd like to talk about that is proper techniques with these brushes. You should be going down to the skin, not just the outer layer. Some people, I see brushes, they just do the outside of the coat. That will make it look okay, but when your judge feels it, it'll still feel all lumpy down in there, and it's not helping the skin. This helps stimulate the coat growth by making the skin very healthy. It also cleans your dog so they won't need to be bathed near as often because the brush picks up a lot of the dirt and you're using the water to rinse it away. When you're using a comb, start with the bigger teeth and then work down. Instead of ripping it, you will just rip out the coat and break it and your dog will learn to hate being groomed. So everything you do has to be done a little bit at a time till your dog gets used to it. Don't try to take the nails all the way back at one time. We'll be showing you how to do that just a little bit at a time. And if you do this, you know, a couple times a week, you can have perfect looking nails within a matter of months. Things that we like are really good quality spray bottles with a really fine mist. Now you won't be able to see this very well, but it should be a real light mist. Nothing too heavy, because your dog will be soaked. Then it'll take forever to dry. When they do wear out, the filters get clogged, just throw it away and buy another. You can get them for $1, $1.50 at most shows. Very cheap. Different products that you can use, we'll be talking about also. I'm not saying that I recommend them, I'm letting you know that they're out there and what they're for. Okay, some people prefer Botifier. This is a texturizing spray concentrate. Helps build up the coat, make it stand off the body more. That's one product. I prefer Syndra Supercoat. And the main reason is it's better. You can use the Botifier. If you show out a 4-day weekend, I guarantee you by the end of that weekend, your dog feels tacky. It also looks dirty. This doesn't. This does not build up the coat, get tacky. It doesn't attract dirt. If it's sticky, it's going to attract dirt. This doesn't do that. I've been using this since it came out, and I love it. I use it all the time, and I can use it for weeks and not bath in between. So that's why I use that. For bathing your dog, I like BioGroom Harsh Coat Shampoo. Okay. You can use other kinds of shampoos. This is just what I prefer. I'm giving you my preferences in shampoo. The reason I like this is I bathed two dogs with that much shampoo. Okay, very little shampoo to be used on your dog. Our dogs are supposed to have a moderately harsh coat, not like terrier, but not soft. Most of the dogs that I see that in the ring, their coats are hanging flat, this will solve that problem. It stands off the body better because it's stiffer, because it makes it harsher. So that's what I like, and a small bottle goes a long way. In between, it shows when your dogs get muddy feet. This is called self-rinse. You mix this up in a spray bottle, spray it on them, towel it off, they're done. You don't have to rinse it off. That's why it's called self-rinse. So they don't have to be soaked all the way to the skin. It helps get rid of the dirt, cleans them up very nicely. I really like that product. Straight scissors that you can use. For people that are just starting out, you should get a blunt tips so you don't puncture your dog. I'll be showing you how to do the pads here in a moment. In between the pads, you can use these type of scissors. There's ones with curved ends on it, real blunt. You can use clippers that you can use. These little wall peanut clippers. It's not too loud, doesn't bother the dog, saves me a lot of time when I'm grooming a lot of dogs. Most dogs don't mind this too much. You can use a bigger clipper if you want to take it with you to a show. I prefer not to take that much stuff to the show. For hocks, I prefer a curved scissor. They're large, but I can get the whole hock done one clip. If you make a mistake, the reason I use a curved blade is according to our standard, the hock should be moderately bent. I accentuate that by using a curved scissor. A lot of people trim their hocks perfectly straight. I don't, it's just my preference. I've done it for so many years, I can't change now. I read the standard when I can make that look moderately bent. So far, I have not seen any that are too straight, actually. I normally notice that they are moderately bent. But that it helps accentuate it. These are probably about $75 a pair. But they last forever. I mean, you can get them sharpened every 6 months, year, depending on how much you use them. Okay, now we're going to go back to the line brushing. She's going to let Luther stand. And when he shakes, you'll be able to see, that was perfect timing, how that stands off of his body. That's what the line brushing does for the coat. It helps make it stand up. It's separating all that impacted undercoat from the skin and making it stand up. It's giving it body. It's not flattened down with dirt. And when the judge runs their hand, and that's the most important thing, that's why we're grooming our dogs. This is all for show, and you could do this just for your pets. When they run their hands down here and it feels like a sheep, they're thinking, this dog's not very well cared for. That could lessen your placement. Not necessarily, but it could. I would much rather run my hand down a nice, clean-feeling dog, one that feels like a special, one that feels like he's been out there campaigned. If you are at the show tomorrow, run your hands across a couple dogs, you'll be able to tell the ones that are line brushed, I guarantee it. Anyway, that's all we're going to do for the line brushing right now. Thank you very much. And now we're going to move to the feet and hocks. Okay, one thing I want to emphasize is how to use a grinder properly. I see a lot of people doing this, holding their grinders, and they invariably are shaking, doing this all over the foot. If you hold your hand like this, there's a button here that stops it. That's not good. Put your fingers over it. Put your thumb at the base. You have perfect control of that. You feel that? Now, you should start by just a little bit at a time on your dog. Hold the nail. not back on the foot. Hold the nail to lessen the vibration. Just that much at a time. Good boy. And praise him for it. Then move to the next foot. And keep going around. When you stop at the last foot, start all over again. A little bit at a time. You'll have those nails back in no time. If you leave the grinder on the nail too long, it will burn the foot. Okay, that will cause a great deal of pain to your dog. He won't like to be groomed anymore. That's usually what I've seen is people either cut the nails too short or they burn them. So as soon as they hear that, they run. So just try just a little bit at a time. Now, it'll be impossible for you to see exactly where to stop from where you're sitting. But there is a very soft spot in the middle of the nail. And if you're grinding properly, you'll be able to see it. Right at the end, it sticks out a little bit. That's when you stop. It's very soft. You can actually push it in. Okay? Then you know you've gone far enough. Okay. Now we're going to trim the tops of the feet. I see a lot of people do this incorrectly. There's many different ways to do it. Good boy. I prefer to mist it with a little bit of water. This helps the hair stay up on end. Now, again, according to our standard, they should be cut footed in the front feet. You can use several things. You can use your thinning shears, straight scissors, or the clippers. These are my little scissors right there. Yeah. Now, I prefer to get down on the dog's level when I do this so I can see what I'm doing and go with the grain. Don't cut sideways, you'll leave lines. And just a little bit at a time. Brush, cut. Okay, I'll see if he'll let me do this with clippers. With these little clippers, you don't have to worry about water too much. With your tail bud. No, I got it. I'm not sure if all of you can see the difference that that's making in the dog's foot. But it's starting to look nice and round and neat. In the front of the foot, I put my thumb under the dog's two front nails and push in and clip out anything sticking past that. That makes the foot much shorter without emphasizing the nails too much, especially if the dog has really long nails. You don't want the nails to stick out too much. So that will make the foot look nice and round. If you can, I don't know if you can see that very well, but the difference between the two feet. Can you see the difference? And that's all it is. It took me, a few seconds to do that. You can use thinning shears the same way, holding the foot this way and clipping off the tips of them. Just a little bit of time, then you might need your straight scissors to neaten it up. Okay? Can we turn him around now, please? I want to show how to do the pads. So have him face this direction. I leave it up. Brush the coat straight up. You mean before you go in the ring? Yes, straight up. It should have a thick foot with thick padding. So you want the foot to look nice and thick, brush that coat straight up. It should have a nice curve to the top of the foot. It should be like a cat foot, nice and round on the top and all the way around. The back foot should be slightly longer. In 25 years, I can tell you I've never had a judge ever say my back feet of my dog were too short. So wouldn't worry about that too much. Trimming the pads, you want to go down into the foot without cutting him. That's the main thing. Don't cut him or you won't be able to do this again.
Not easily.
As you can see, they're kind of web-footed. in there. You can catch those with scissors, so you have to be pretty careful. Like I said, the blunt tip scissors for people that haven't done it much would be the best thing to use, because then you won't have to worry about jamming your scissors down in the dog's foot. Or again, the clippers. Same thing. Spread the toes apart with your fingers. This will help tighten up the dog's feet, give a much tidier appearance. They have much better traction on all surfaces. They won't be dragging in mud, leaves, snowballs, ice, and all that into your house. That's how it should look when you're finished. Nice and clean. It only takes a few seconds with the clippers. I prefer those. I understand everybody won't go out and buy those, but I like them. Now we're going to do the hocks. I usually start with a slicker brush, brush it up, then down, and up again. You're trying to loosen that up before I take a comb to it, because you don't want to have to rip it. Just pull it all straight out from behind. Big scissors. I don't know if everybody can see this okay. I use my finger to help hold the hock. Trim it nice and neat. Just gives nicer appearance from a distance, that dog's hock. Any stray hairs, you just trim off. You can also do this with thinning shears, especially if you're afraid of doing this, because this will only take a little bit off at a time. Okay? You should brush the coat out in every direction. And with the dog standing with that foot perfectly straight, you can see if it's straight. And he doesn't carry a whole lot of coat on his hocks at his age. He's very young, but he'll get plenty more. But you want to have a nice straight line through the hock. If it's crooked when the dog is moving, that's what the judge is going to see. If you've got this sticking out this way, your dog's going to look like he's cow-hocked when he's moving. Again, you can correct a lot of faults in the rear by scissoring. But remember, when your dog is standing still, you know, if he moves cow-hocked and you've trimmed it the other way, when he's standing straight, it's going to be noticeable that you've trimmed it. So that's something you want to consider when you're doing that. That's the easiest way to do the hocks, the top of the feet. We're going to let him down now. He's helping us out here, and he's doing a very good job. Okay, he can get off now. Yeah, good boy. Okay. Okay, a few things that I have seen in the ring, time and time and time and time and time again, is a lot of waves in the dog's coat. A dog standing, stand low, good boy, with a big curl right here, draws your attention to that big curl and his croup. If the dog has a really steep croup, that's the first thing you're going to notice is that dog's croup. So you need to minimize that. If he has a slight roach in his top line and there's a curl right here, that's the first thing you're going to see. If he's lacking height at withers, you can fix that too, the same way. So I'm going to show you how to take out some waves and curls in dogs' coats. A lot of it is due to genetics. A lot of it is due to the way you're bathing and drying your dogs. And if they're slightly damp, they run in the house, lay in a crate, pretty likely you're going to have curls in the dog's coat. When you're grooming your dog at a show, and he has a slight curl in his coat, if he's not completely dry, if he's slightly damp, the curl will come back. You're going to do this the same way your hairdresser would do it. I learned to do all this grooming by looking